Hello everyone and welcome to One Teacher, One Scientist. So today we are here on Facebook to discuss a pertinent issue that has been troubling not just any one region or a city or a state or a country, but the world at large. And that is how COVID has impacted learning among children. In 2019, when COVID hit us, I think we, as a human race, we were totally unprepared. We were just not prepared for something like this. And suddenly we found ourselves in the middle of a crisis, which actually led us into a bigger crisis, which is showing up now as a huge education crisis. So today we are in discussion with two eminent people of the industry, Mrs. Lata Rana, ma'am, who is the principal of Nilgiri Hills Public School, Noida, and Dr. Mala Bhandari, who's the founder of Sadrag, an NGO that has been working in this space for decades now. So welcome to One Teacher, One Scientist, Lata ma'am and Mala ma'am.
Thank you, Vishali ma'am.
And today, I think it's a very pertinent issue that we are all grappling with, and that is the education system and what to do to help our children learn. You know, when Corona hit us, I think we as a society just went into a fight and flight mode where the teachers suddenly had to shift to an online platform. Most of them were caught unaware of how to use that platform, what to do, how to handle the situation as such. I must say that the teachers have really, really worked hard and they've tried their best to mitigate the situation. But somewhere I feel that we are in the middle of a deeper crisis. How do you think, Lata ma'am, schools were handling this whole coronavirus issue and how the pandemic, you know, I would say what the pandemic left us with? How do you think schools handle this issue? And where do you think lied the biggest problem?
Had there been no technological advancement, education system would have reached a vacuum. Online teaching came as a saving grace initially, and now indeed has become a strong hand to carry on with teaching learning process in the schools. We talk of challenges while we teach online. I take it as a blessing in disguise. If we talk of challenges while we teach online, I take it a really very positive aspect. And our teachers are now comfortably managing the session on the different virtual platforms. Now they are able to run videos, share screens, go for virtual experiments, and make online classes interesting and lively. But definitely, road was full of turn and twist when we started with the online teaching. Many challenges came on our way, and we count them on my fingers. The foremost challenge was on our way was the adaptability. Students found it difficult to adapt to an online learning environment as they were turned to traditional classroom learning. The very mindset of physical classroom environment became an obstruction, and students were not able to focus on the online platform. And Vaishali ma'am, let me just speak before you that even parents, you know, they turned hostile in the sense that they were very resistant and they took online teaching as no teaching. So that was the biggest challenge we did face when we really started with the online teaching. And the second biggest challenge was the technical issues. Getting onto the virtual learning came up with that poor, internet connectivity at students and teachers level. If I count again on my fingers, and the third challenge was. That was with regard to that technological handling issues, the proficiency which we suffered at every level, talk of teachers, talk of students, even the parents who were there at their support. So that was also one of the challenges. Gradually, I could see the parents extended their support, and really they started taking our online teaching seriously. There is umpteen challenges, but I am here to just come to put forward those challenges which really made us really to work on the toes, and they were the motivation.
Yeah,
like one of the factors was I could find children were not motivated at all. Human touch, as it goes with the physical classroom, was missing when it came to the virtual classrooms.
Right.
Monotonous classes, one after another, without physical movement of the children who were confined to the four walls of their homes, made teaching and learning, or rather I'll call it compulsive experience, ma'am.
Yeah, true. I can imagine. I mean, we were seeing, there were so many news articles about it. We were seeing it online, how difficult it was for teachers to adapt, for parents to take, and to understand, for the parents also to understand that actually this is what is happening. I mean, learning is happening as far as your child goes. I mean, it must have been very tough at that point. And when schools were facing such a tough time, I'm sure children of the community must be also facing a really tough time. I mean, how, considering that these are coming from backgrounds where technology may not be even available. So, Mala ma'am, I would like to understand from you, how did you adapt to this change, considering the kind of constraints and challenges that you must have faced in the community? So what kind of challenges did you face when children had to be sent back home? There were these lockdowns after lockdowns, and children were not able to come physically to the centers. How did you manage that time, and how did you ensure that learning was happening?
Thank you to Lata ji that she explained the institutional part of learning for children very well.
Yeah,
she actually summarized how the school as an institution adapted itself to the changing times. Whether it succeeded or not, whether it did well or not is a separate story altogether. What had happened was, overnight, we were thrown before the virus of corona. And the major thing with this was the fear about contracting the virus. This fear was so much that we as humans, had actually become numb.
Right.
We didn't know how to react, because this was an unseen virus with nobody knew about. Research was at a very nascent stage. The government didn't know how to react. So whatever reactionary responses could take place, the government did that.
Okay.
Now, you have raised a very pertinent thing, that if we are talking of the school's education in an institution of school, then what happened to those children who were not a part of any institution? That is, children who were in the community. We have been working with children who are out of school, and we prepare them for the formal school system. Our children are in the age group 6 to 14. Right? So when in March corona struck us, our children were getting prepared to enter the formal school system. And just then that there was a catastrophe, that the national lockdown was announced, and the centers, the learning and support centers for children, which were in the community, had to be shut down. The moment these centers were shut down, the learning for these children shut in itself.
Right.
Because a lot of things came up. Our education system, like Lataji just talked about, it overnight again, within a few moments, two things emerged immediately. One was the inadequacy of our education system. The other was inequity, right? Inadequacy means the education system was not adequate enough to switch over to the online system, because we have been having the conventional mode of teaching.
Right.
The teachers, the teaching faculty, the students, the children were all accustomed to one particular way of delivery of teaching learning experience. Yeah. So the school was very fast, very prompt to adopt to it. But what about NGOs? What about the organizations like us who were grappling with the inadequacy as well as inequity of the education system? Now, inadequacy was in terms of the preparation, the lack of preparation. And inequity was how imbalance were present within the children. The children with resources and children without resources. The children with resources could immediately have the digital tools to follow the online learning imparted by the schools. We as organizations had no such facilities or no such resources. Our children were coming from the migrant communities. They had no digital tools at all. If at all they have, then one mobile phone, the smartphone, which is in the range of 4,000 to 5,000 rupees, was shared within the family of 4, 5, 6 people.
Yeah.
And so even if we tried to give the online learning, the children were not able to do so, because one, there was a lack of digital tools, and second was lack of supportive environment, which was not so serious when it came to school teaching. I was coming across parents who were sitting with children and glued to the screen what is taught by the teacher, so that they could help their child later to learn the thing, to learn the lesson. So yeah, there was some support, if not 100%, to yeah, some extent, of course, there was support, because parents were educated, formally educated. So they could, still come up with things that we have to support. We have to bring that ecosystem at home so that the child can learn something, which was lacking, completely lacking in community children.
Correct.
So there was struggle for food. There was struggle because there was loss of livelihood. Another man would be able to again explain it very well, how she found the gap between the children with haves and children with have-nots. That how they grappled, the school as an institution grappled with this digital gap also, and the lack of supportive ecosystem at their place. How, I'm sure there was a big fight, and that fight is still on.
Correct. I mean, if we talk of the children coming from advantaged backgrounds, having those resources and still grappling with so many issues. So children who did not have resources, for them, learning must have completely stopped. Yeah. I mean, I fail to understand how we can bridge this digital divide, considering such a huge one exists in our country. Many times people in various other countries would not even understand the kind of digital divide that we have in our country. And there are so many children who perhaps have got totally cut off from the learning process because the structured learning has completely stopped. And I'm sure there must be so much fear right now, even among parents, to send their children back to school because the pandemic is still there. It's not that it's gone. So, you know, considering that we were so underprepared, I think everybody was underprepared all across the globe. Nobody envisaged such a thing could happen. And everywhere, I think people are grappling with this issue. But somewhere I feel that this response of reducing the syllabus, you know, how we have also responded by reducing the curriculum, by reducing the syllabus, and maybe make it simpler for teachers to teach and simpler for children to learn because everything is happening online. But do you think reduction of the syllabus is the right way forward? And do you think this can be an answer to the dilemma that we are in? Lata ma'am, what according to you would be a better way to mitigate this challenge that we are grappling with? Or do you think reduction in the syllabus is the right way forward?
We need to keep our focus on learning outcomes intact, but also to give stress-free environment to the students. The rationalization of syllabus, if we talk of, has to be read and understood in right spirit.
Yeah.
So it is the responsibility of the schools and the teachers, the topics which are reduced, they are to be explained to the students to the extent required to connect with the different topics. So the purpose of reducing the syllabus is to mitigate the effect of loss of instruction time, which has taken place not on the part of teachers, but also on the part of the students. Other aspect which I would like to touch upon, as online classes, if we presume that these are the one-way traffic system, it gains speed. As classroom, the physical classroom, we have one-to-one involvement. So the process is not there. So we can actually speed up with the lessons. But this process of rationalizing the syllabus should not be taken as a straight jacketed approach. We need to make learning outcomes intact, as I said before. So very well said by Vishali Madam, that we need to just introspect that whether it is that transactional methodology that has to be changed. So we have to go for constructive deliberations and actions at our end.
Yeah, because I personally feel it is the transactional methodology that has changed. You know, like when we are switching from an offline to an online learning system, the entire mode of transaction has changed. So there needs to be a change in the way we are transacting the topics, maybe some different kind of pedagogical approaches that need to be mitigated in this whole thing. You know, maybe that is where we need to also introspect how to make the learning space more powerful for both the teachers as well as for the students. I would say there is a lot that we can do. I mean, online or a digital space gives a lot of freedom to the teachers, but yes, it requires a different transactional methodology altogether, I feel. So, Mala ma'am, coming to you, what do you think is the way forward in when we talk of children in the community? Because as we can see, Corona seems to be here to stay for a longer time than what we thought it would. So in such a situation, what are the kind of challenges that you visualize as we move forward in the learning process? And how do you think we can mitigate it as far as these community children go? I know that the SLATE program is running in your centers and the teachers are finding it very useful. But how do you see this whole learning ecosystem changing when we talk of community children?
I think this is the major challenge in contemporary times. How do we, you know, keep the learning process alive with the for the community children? Now, there are various aspects to it. Mm-hmm. One, like I said, that we make the digital tools accessible to these children, so that at least they have the tool with them. You know, so we during Corona, we came up with this concept of digital lab, where we can talk, where we said, okay, that people who have used digital tools can give it to us so that we can give it to the children and youth who need it. And, you know, so that at least they can keep the learning process regular. And this was that an ownership model, that let this device be owned by that person. Now, we realized that it had a very limited reach. So now we have changed it to the concept of digital library, where, you know, we have a repository of digital tools, and the child who is in need can borrow it from us for varying period of times. We have got a workable model also for it. It's yet to take off, but we are very serious about it, because at least to whatever extent we can, we should be able to solve the accessibility aspect first of all. Once the accessibility is solved, then maybe we can take the next step. And the next step may be that we digitalize our learning material.
Yeah.
Like we have the Slate program, and it's a beautiful program which is based on experiential learning, and children are enjoying it too. Why don't we digitalize it? So that if tomorrow, when the third wave of Corona, as we are anticipating, hits us in the last week of August or so, at least the children can have the digitalized learning material. Because, you know, Vishali, what is happening is we are de-skilling our children. Why? Yeah. Because no learning is taking, no effective learning is taking place.
Yeah.
Now, if we have restored, or if we have started with this program, then we are able to benefit only a limited number of children through this program. So what about the rest? How about their skilling, their learning? So we are in fact de-skilling these children, which is a very serious issue. You know, today they are 10 years old. Tomorrow they'll be 11, 12 years old. And we don't know how long this corona thing is going on. So that means the period of de-skilling is elongated, is enlarged. And it's becoming very, very uncertain when this level is going to get over.
Correct.
We actually have to move towards digitalization. But if you ask me at a very personal level, I have my very strong apprehensions about this unprecedented continuation of digital learning too.
Correct. Absolutely, because children have to have a hands-on learning approach. See, when they come to the centers and they do the Slate program, they really enjoy themselves, and a lot of learning takes place. Whereas when I look at the online system as a very passive teaching method. I don't know why, that's my personal opinion. But it's like, you know, how we got televisions earlier. So it became like a secondary mode of teaching or watching things. So similarly, I feel in the long run, online will need to be a lot more, you know, based with simulators and everything to make it very interactive. Otherwise, it can have an element of being a passive teaching methodology.
But I would like to mention that all the challenges which are being faced by all of us, the children have now adopting themselves to the online learning processes. Like technically, they are sound. They have also achieved the technical efficiency. And gradually, I have seen there is a shift in the mindset. And that is why, over the time, I have seen that there is an escalation in the attendance, the daily attendance of students in the virtual classroom, and that is a welcome, you know, stage.
Yeah, that's very nice. That's very welcoming.
Yes.
I mean, because that is what one wants. That means somewhere, at some level, children are finding it useful. Because then that means that slowly, over a period of time, both the teachers and children are getting used to this space and may just find this useful. We just need to find the right balance. But what about the community children, Mala? Because I am still skeptical of how children in the community would take to online learning, because it's not just about a gadget or a smartphone. It's about, you know, getting to use them as well. You know, not every family or not every child would be well versed in handling these equipments. And then the cost part, you know, there is a running cost involved as well. So how do you think this entire ecosystem can work for community children?
I think we, if the schools are proving to be the institution which can succeed in imparting the online teaching learning experience to the child, and children are able to cope up with it, then government has to take this issue very seriously. That means the out-of-school children, hordes of out-of-school children, need to be put in school, need to be sent in school. So as the Right to Education Act 2009 says, that we have to put our children, the children in this age group need to be in school, we have to expedite this process.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah. So that, because for community children, the education, the formal education of a child is not an isolated issue.
Yeah.
It is interrelated with the livelihood of the parents, with the parents' preparation for the child.
Correct.
So that if they have the livelihood, if they have, even if it's a migrant worker and he has a steady source of income, that is, he's able to ply the rickshaw on the road, he has a petty shop which he was running on the roadside on a regular basis, you know, or maybe he is employed as a guard in some residential society or a factory, and he has some regularity in the flow of income to the family, the mindset will change.
Right.
Yeah, and what will happen is the parents then don't have to worry for the food to be available at home in the evening.
Correct.
Children will not go hungry.
Yeah.
Yeah. So then, you know, what will happen is that they will say, yes, here is this institution, the school, which needs, we have to send our children. This is, you know, what we are doing, Vishali. We are distributing the ration kits. Why are we distributing it? Because people have still lost, have not been able to get back to their livelihood.
Yeah.
Jobs are not there. So we want that, you know what we are trying to ensure through these ration kits? That if our ration kit is able to cater to the food needs of a family of four members for a period of 15 to 20 days, at least those 20 days, the family will not have to be worried for food, and they can invest their energies and time looking for work.
Correct. Absolutely, Mala. Absolutely. You know, the challenges are so many and so diverse that no one solution can fit everybody. We have to look at these challenges on a more diverse perspective with, you know, the situation being different for different people. We need to find solutions which are tailor-made for each situation. And I think that requires a lot of discussion and debate. And we should encourage more discussions like this so that we come up with viable solution, you know, for our society. And at the end of the day, it is those children who need to learn. And it is those children who will become the country's future. So if we have to really build the future of our country, I think we need to sit together, brainstorm, get a variety of ideas, and try and find a viable solution to issues that we are all grappling with, that Corona has left us open to. And I think 2 years down the line now, almost 2 years since the pandemic hit, I think it's high time that we start looking at it in a more pragmatic manner and start looking for solutions in a more realistic manner and holistic way, so that at the end of the day, we are helping our children learn. Thank you so much, Lata ma'am and Mala ma'am, for being here with us on Facebook. And I hope we can create some sort of a thought process so that everybody in the country is thinking how to help these children learn and how to ensure that learning does not stop at every level. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Vaishnavi.
Thank you.